when he's through working, you won't even recognize the situation because he's going to change it so good. Now, years ago, there was a church in Lake Wales, Church of God, actually called me, and I preached there several revivals there in the previous years, and the man over the new pastor had come in, and they called and asked if I'd go speak at a men's meeting. And I went to speak at the men's meeting, and it was full of men. They had over 100 men in that church. And that's a miracle in itself, to get that many men to go to church. And so, anyway, I could tell that the atmosphere had gotten full of religion since I'd been there, and it was full enough when I was there. And so, I give them a word, and preach to them a word, and had to get down on their level to talk to them. And when I got through it, got to minister by the gifts. And there was a little brother sitting on the about halfway back. It looked like death warmed over. And the Lord said, that man's got 7 diseases working in his body. And he's a dying. One of them was cancer. And he said, call him out and tell him he shall live and not die. That I'm breaking these things off of him and the scene is changing. And I called him out and prophesied to him, the glory of God come on him. And I went on my way. And about, good Lord, at least 6-7 years later, we moved into parsonage over here and we were remodeling it. And some rooms had been very needed updating, and we had hung drywall, and then another team come in and blessed us. The Lord blessed us, and they come in, texturized money, didn't charge us a dime. And so they brought a crew to work in there, and there's a man looked good. He's heavy, big, and strong, and every time he looked at me, he'd just laugh and smile, and I didn't know who he was. And the last day when they left, he came over to me, and he said, you don't know me, and I know you don't. But he said, about 6-7 years ago, you called me out at a meeting in Lake Wales. I had 7 diseases. Boy, when he said 7 diseases, I knew who he was. But I want you to know that man had gained over 55 pounds, had become a large, strong, working man again. All the cancer left, all the diabetes left, all the blood disorders left. God healed that. See, I didn't judge that man by what I seen at that moment. I judged him according to the word of God. And the word said, you shall live and not die. Hallelujah. And then 7 years later, he appeared in his healed form. Hallelujah. And I didn't even know him. I want you to know the Lord's able to turn something so that you don't even recognize it when you see it again. We're getting too familiar with the way it is now. That's what the Holy Ghost is saying to you. You're getting too familiar with the way it is now. You're getting too comfortable. You're getting too used to it. But the Lord would say unto thee this morning, it is time to let a new horizon come unto thee, saith the Lord thy God. It is time for a new vision to take hold of thy sight, saith the Lord thy God. And thou shalt no longer allow these things to tread upon thee or to trample upon thee. But yea, ye shall lift up your eyes and behold another dimension, and behold another realm, saith the Lord, and you shall soon see surely that I have turned back, hallelujah, that has tried to trample upon thee, and I have set thee in a large place, saith the Lord, and a place of blessing and a place of glory. Hallelujah. Ooh, shalom, Hassan. Glory to God. So get your mind made up. You're not going to get adjusted. I'm not adjusting myself to fit things that don't fit in the Word. Come on now. I'm not adjusting my views to embrace stuff that the Word don't embrace. The Word says, if so, I'll embrace it. But if the Word says it ain't so, then I'm not going to set up housekeeping with it. Can you say praise the Lord? God, I'm talking to people. these days. I just want to scream. Don't you know the word said you don't have to go through that? Don't he not by shut out of my heart? Don't you know the word says that he's already overcome that? Don't you know that you're just living in a place of shortness? You're coming short of the promise? Hallelujah. And in their own blessed hearts and minds, they feel there's no way out. But my God, today, I'm telling you, don't judge it as you see it. Don't judge it as you hear it. But judge it as the Word of God has spoken it, as the Word of God has said it. Can you say praise the Lord? And I'll tell you one more thing, and I'm leaving you with that for the lesson to come forth today. But you better start getting an open receiving spirit. Because I'm going to tell you something. When the Lord speaks to you in here, that's your way out of anything. And you can't ignore and carry on and push back what's said in here and then run out there and God going to hit me with a big now. He ain't going to hit you. Right here is where it starts. This is a starting line. Oh, hallelujah. This is a starting line. It comes first in word before it manifests in power. Glory to God. And the Lord wants you to sharpen up and get a keen ear to hear what's being said in this hour. Can you say amen? There's a spirit of lethargy just all in the church right now. I'm not just talking about this building. I'm talking about the church as a whole. People's rocking to sleep. They've about dozed off, and the bridegroom is coming to meet us in another round. Hallelujah. And somebody called the watchman. Glory to God. Has got to shout out, you better shake it off. Glory. Better rise up, because we're moving out. Glory to God. We're moving on into something better. I ain't standing. You stand if you want to. I'm leaving this round behind and going on into another. If I ever heard truth, G.C. McCurry said that spiritual growth is represented by change after change after change after change. Amen. Old Kelly Varner, he purposed that statement forth in every book he wrote. Change after change after change after change. Really, the change is metamorphosis. You're shedding off something.
Yes.
Gotta fall behind. God ain't gonna glorify things that's out of the Word. He only witnesses His own Word, because His Word is the only truth. There ain't no truth outside of Him. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Isn't it good to know that we're all designed to encounter such truth? Hallelujah, that it's not something that's foreign to you. It's not something that you have to strive and work for, but by design, you're made up to not just encounter it, to become what you encounter, and to be a reflection of that truth. Jesus said that they shall what? Know the truth. And the truth shall what?
Make you free.
And when we look at the embodiment and the personification of Jesus Christ, it is the complete truth as regarding you. And it is the complete truth. Jesus said that, you know, if you've seen me, you've seen who? So if it wasn't revealed in Jesus, then it ain't God. It's not Father. But it didn't just come to reveal and redeem that. He came to reveal and redeem what we believed about our own self. See, if we believe that God called us to survive, then we would have to look at the story of the children of Israel and cut it off in the wilderness. Because if He took them out of Egypt to live a survival of the fittest, so to say, then why would He have ever invited them to come into the promised land? Because that was the invitation. The invitation was not to come to the wilderness. The invitation all along was to come into the land that was flowing with milk and honey, to a land that had houses for you to dwell in that you didn't build, to eat off of a crop that you didn't plant. It sounds like you've been set up for something that you had nothing to do with. Amen. Matter of fact, you didn't even give him permission to do it. He went ahead and did it for you. And that's the beauty of the salvation plan of God, is that it's so front-loaded. You know, nowadays in sports and things like that, you get a contract, and they'll give you a little bit of money up front, but then they load this thing with what they call incentives. And then as your, say it's a 5-year contract, and as it's going on and going on and going on, the better you perform, come on, the more is bestowed upon you. Well, that's not how the gospel is. The gospel is so accurate, so precise in this thing. He's so persuaded in what Jesus Christ did that he absolutely just pours it all on you. Without you asking for it, without you begging for it, without you getting the right, because see, this whole thing, when Paul says, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is what? The power of God unto salvation, unto them that believe." Oh, how many happy this morning that you came already pre-wired. See, the thing, hallelujah, Jesus walks by the fig tree. He looks at the fig tree. He wants figs. There's no figs on it. And he curses the fig tree, and he goes on about his business. Never doubting one moment that when he released that word, that when he said that no one's ever going to eat of your fruit again, that when once he said it, it was a done deal. It's called the law of confession. It's no different. I mean, if we were to fly in a plane, there's a law of aerodynamics. It don't matter if you got a little plane, or you got a big 747, or you got one of them big jumbo things now that you can just basically swim in a swimming pool in nowadays. But it doesn't matter. When you get to a certain point, there's a law of aerodynamics, a law of lift that takes over, that oversees the law of gravity. And what Jesus was trying to relate to them, that there is a law of saying things, a law of speaking the word, a law of confessing things. And we ain't talking about just saying whatever. We're talking about saying exactly what the word has to say about you. Right. And saying exactly what God has openly declared in Jesus Christ. Because Hebrews tells us that in times past he spoke to us by the law and by the prophets in many diverse ways. But now he's spoken to who? Us. Through what? The Son. You're God's audience. When he speaks, he's speaking to you. When he declares anything, he is an in-your-face God. He's not trying to get you to hear an echo of something he said many, many moons ago and it finally got to you. No, he is a personalized God that comes in your face. Oh, hallelujah. And see, what does religion do? Religion thrives on two things. The first one's distance. The very thing that religion wants to do is keep heaven and earth, first of all, away from each other. Then it wants to keep you and God away from each other.
Amen.
Then it wants to keep you and the promise away from each other. And then he wants to keep you in the life of the ages that he's already redeemed and restored and oh, hallelujah, and quickened in you. What does he want to do? He wants to keep us in the resurrection away from each other. And you see the procession that Jesus goes through. And so he says this thing to the fig tree. Everybody's standing around. They hear it. They go to the temple. That time at the temple is when he platted the whip and drove the money changers out. Because what was going on there? Trying to separate people from the most holy place. You see what See, he, oh, glory to God. He came, if I could say it this way, he came to redeem the oneness.
Hallelujah.
He came to remove every sense of thought of separation that mankind had developed in his own way of thinking through the fall. Through the fall. The very sense that Adam walked in was that there was a separation because he went and hid like he separated himself from God. But even in the beginning, when all this takes place, God didn't hide himself from Adam. He was never confused about it. He didn't catch him off guard. Why? Because he already seen the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world. Jesus looks at a bunch of them and says, hold up. You don't even know anything about Abraham. You say he's your father. He ain't your father. He said your father is the father of lies. How do you know this? Come on. Because Abraham what? Seen my day. And what did he do? He rejoiced in it. Now let's go back to that little story. Because remember, here comes Abraham. He's received the promise. Everything came according to God's plan. He goes up there. He's got Isaac. He looks at the servants and he says, y'all stay right here. Me and the lad are about to go up on the mountain and sacrifice. And what does he say? We will return. So they go up there. They build the altar. And he's getting ready to sacrifice Isaac. And he gets to the point where he brings the knife up. And lo and behold, he hears something. But I want you to go back and look at that story, because where did he hear it? He heard a lamb coming up now behind him. You see, faith sees the future in past tense. Faith sees the future in a tense that has already took place. So God was not confused. Because when God sits down on that seventh day, it ain't cause he's tired. When he enters into rest, it ain't cause he's wore out. He enters into the rest on the Sabbath day because he looks at what all he's created, man included, which was the climax. Come on. The crescendo. Ooh, of everything that was going on was mankind made in his image and his likeness. And he looks at it. Mind you, why Eve is not even existent in Eve's form, which is a rabbit trail we're not going to go down. But he looks at man in his completeness and says, it not just that it's good, it is what? Very good. And he goes into rest. In other words, he goes into a celebration. That what he sees in man is the exact reflection of himself.
All right.
And there's nowhere in that Bible that you find him coming out of that rest. Why? Because not only did he see his image and likeness created in man, he's seen it redeemed in man. So it didn't throw him off his rocker, so to say. It didn't cause him to start, you know, storming and pacing down the streets of heaven to find, you know what I'm saying, what are we going to do now?
Right.
Paul in Athens says that he had appointed a date that, what?
come to the world in righteousness by a man. You see, if there is no sense in your life this morning, if there's one hint of condemnation, one hint of guilt, of suspicion, what happens? The effect of faith is void. Because without that transparency of you not feeling guilty, condemned, accused, there's no anything you see in the Word. Come on, anything that's revealed in the pulpit, anything that comes to you in a dream, there's no distance in it. Come on, I've been so guilty of seeing something, looking at it face to face, beholding it, and then in my own mind, I start a process of things I need to get rid of, you know what I'm saying, and all this stuff like that. When I come to find out, just let the glory come in the house. Just let that become your life, because anything that's going to be removed, the glory pushes it out. There's no need. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. There's no need for you to start trying to eliminate this, eliminate. While we look not at the things which are seen, but we look at the things which are not seen. Why? Because they hold such a far more exceeding weight of glory. And when we look at that, everything that's contrary to it is just pushed. Pushed out. And you know what? Come to find us without any effort. I mean, you wake up one day and it's not there. That someone asked me last weekend, because his brother had been on drugs and got out of drugs and got back into drugs, and he asked me, he said, Chris, I always want to ask you this. What happened? I told him, you know what, I don't have a formula. I don't have a, 12-step, 10-step, don't even have a 2-step, man. You know? There's not 101 ways that I know of to live a conflict-free life. I said, all I know is I woke up one morning. And I no longer identified with that. But there was such a newness, such a freshness. What had happened? Oh, I just woke up to a new world. You know what I mean? And maybe subconsciously, you know what I'm saying? I mean, you go through that, and you didn't want to be hooked on drugs, and you didn't want to do this and stuff like that. But I tell you what, be honest with you, I didn't want to be free from it. I wasn't begging God to take it away from me. But I woke up one morning, and all of a sudden, I found myself actually seeing where I always was. Actually beginning to see what God saw about me, even when I may have been dressed in the most disturbing disguises. Just like Mother Teresa, they asked Mother Teresa, what is it about you that would go in the darkest nights and at the darkest wee hours of the morning into the most remote places when you could actually, if you want to feed the hungry, you could have it there at the Vatican. You'd have millions of people come. He said, why would you go? She says, because I seek to serve my Lord in His most disturbing disguises. What a thought. What a way to live your life. Well, you can look beyond the garment. You can look beyond what's going on. You can look beyond the circumstances and see the image in the likeness of God. And minister that. You remember in the book, Monkeys and Dragons, little Sarah that was in there with Priscilla Dahl that was in a sane asylum, had been there, lived there, was born there, had spent her whole life there. And they would have vigils around the clock where this deal, so many people would come in and pray during the day, and so many people come in and pray during the night, and she works there, so she would run her shift. And she came home one morning, and one of the ladies that was also there praying had called her and said, I had a dream last night. And in that dream, it was like a drum, and there was this little Sarah down in the bottom of that drum, and she was calling out, help me. Help me. Help me. At that moment, Michelle knew that the one they seen in the asylums, you know, strapped to that bed was not Sarah. That the real Sarah was down in there asking to be released. So that day she went in, and of course they was all doing the same old stuff, you know, singing the same old songs and praying the same old prayers. And she got down there by Sarah's ear and began to speak to the one that they seen in the drum.
Right.
She said everyone around was thinking, what in the world is she doing? Because as she began to pray and call forth that one and begin to sing songs to that one,
yeah.
Old Sarah, woo, she started bucking, she started screaming, she started foaming, she started doing everything else. And all of a sudden, she gets fell out. And the next morning, when she went into that place, guess what? The real Sarah, the true Sarah, that ain't confused about who she is, hallelujah, was up,
right,
talking, walking, saying, let me out. After she had spent over 20-something years in a place of, folks, it don't take 10 years, glory be to God, to get people to walk in this, Lord. Just one encounter of the truth will change people's lives forever. Now, what is the deal? For those that are asleep in their unbelief and indifference, you are the wake-up call. Because you've had the truth presented to you, encountered to you. So it ain't for just this right here. With a wake-up call that announces that the wait is over. How many times in this, especially in the New Testament, the very word that's translated in the King James, wait or coming, is parousia. Guess what it doesn't mean? Wait or coming. You see what we're dealing with? We're dealing with centuries and centuries and decades of dealing with a mindset of a translation that was written to keep people down, not up. So what happens if you put delay and distance in it? Come on. People come back and come back for the wrong reason. You see, when you understand and you discover the immediate presence, that's what parousia means. The immediate presence of God. It doesn't make you want to come less. It makes you want to encounter it even more. Because that's what this thing, how in the world, what Jesus says to Nicodemus, how in the world could you even have an appetite to come out at night and encounter the kingdom of God, unless that was where you came from to begin? You see that? I mean, we got family that's moved on from this place, from Bartow, so to say, and lives in different cities and different states. You know, we could sometimes you'd see them on Facebook or say something like, man, I sure miss my fried chicken.
Yeah.
I mean, they could literally taste it in their mouth.
Yeah.
How could they do that? Why could they do that?
Amen.
Only if they had tasted Mike's fine fried chicken before. Nicodemus, even have a desire to look into the kingdom of God? How could you even have a desire to see the things of God? To know it, to perceive, not from a distance now. We're talking about to encounter it face to face. How could that even draw you out from where you are? Unless,
my.
Unless you had already tasted it before. Unless, glory be to God, that is the very city, the very place of which you came from. So Jesus says, on their return back, profound statement that's been misinterpreted, mistranslated, Mark 11. He says, have the faith of God. Not have faith in God. You see, that's what we've... The Christian world is the most divided world there is. The religious, well, come on. We can go down here, bend the right, bend another left. We find somebody else's faith in God. We can go up there before we even get to McLeod Park, look to the left. There's a little, where the old women's meeting thing used to be. What? There's somebody else there gathered because of their faith in God. Go up the road, look to the right, there's another faith in God. See what happened? What it is. Faith in God just gives us the right to have our own opinion.
Right.
What we believe in God.
Right.
What we mean it. And you know what the sickening part about it is the minute that somebody in a congregation believes something a little different than what the pastor does, guess what they're going to do? Go start them another meeting on the side of the corner over there so they can celebrate what they believe in God. But it was never about what you believed about God. It was always about what He believed about you. So until all that gets moved out of the way and we quit living by our faith in Him and start being persuasive of His faith in us, we'll keep having division after division after division after division. And listen, Abraham had no reference of faith until God told him what he believed. There's one faith. Come on. One faith. Not what you believe about God. What God believes about you. That's what matters. That's what matters. That's what matters. That's what changes things. That's what awakens people's hearts. Paul would say, when we were in our worst place, we were indifferent to Him. We were hostile to Him. We were rebellious to Him. I mean, we weren't even religious holy rollers running around the church saying, Shukamahanda. We was not even, we was so far from it. That did not change Him. He did not have to reassess things. He didn't come in after 15 years when there wasn't no Isaac there and Abraham's womb still barren, and he didn't sit Abraham down and say, you know what? We got to realign our thoughts concerning this thing. You know what? It just ain't going to happen. I mean, I told you, promise is coming through you and Sarah, and here you are. We're 20 years into it now. So let's, instead of calling yourself Abraham, start calling yourself Abe. Short. Because you're not the father of any. No. He was persuaded of the promise. What made Abraham righteous? He simply believed what God said about him. It only takes the theology of man to make this gospel so confusing. It only takes cemetery after cemetery. Do you know all these fathers that were in the Latter Rain movement started off walking into a seminary and the Holy Ghost said, get out of there.
Get out.
Why? Because they'd have been trapped in the same old mindset of all this and still confused about who man is, who God is. But man, he said, have the... Can you can you consider for me this morning that he told you to believe? You're able, whatever God believes, you can believe it. That it's not foreign to you, that the fact. The fact that you're faith compatible ought to let you know your God's. Yeah. And we're not just dealing with some little blind faith that just gets you from A to B. No. Gets you from meal to meal. Yeah. We're talking about the faith that created the universe. According to Ephesians, everything that was framed was framed by the faith of God. And Jesus whips around and says, have the faith of God. He wouldn't have said it if you couldn't have it. Peter's like, whoa, what? You see the difference in identity. Not knowing your origin, not knowing where you came from, not knowing your purpose. And this whole deal. Spending year after year after year in survival mode. But our little Swiss Army knife, we got this one for this, we got this for that, we got this for that. Come on. We got gadgets, we got utensils, we got whatever we need, man. We got enough to make, and we never enter into the rest.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
When Paul clearly takes in Hebrews, yeah, and he draws a complete picture of all this that's going on, and the supernatural's going on, and the signs and wonders are going on, and getting fed every morning with manna. Come on, there's a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. They was not without the supernatural taking part in their life. Every day they seen the hand of God. Every single day. Every moment. God's presence was immediate in their life. And they did not, come on, enter in to the rest, to the promise. Why? Because of one thing. Unbelief. Hold up. I don't mean because they didn't manufacture up some faith. It's because they did not believe what God believed about it. That's the only thing that hinders us. Come on. There's no devil. You said there's no devil in hell. Come on. In other words, there's no thought in the unknown. Come on. That can rob you.
That's right.
Satan can't do it. Let's visit that for a second. Yeah. Satanos, or whatever we say in the Greek. You know what it means? Accuser. An accusation. Remember when Paul talks about having the thorn in his flesh? I mean, and the thing about a thorn is, it can be the littlest thorn. And it can demand the most astounding attention.
Yeah, amen. Yeah.
I remember as a kid one time, I was playing at Carolyn Pacetti's house and got a thorn. It was right at Christmas time. Failed and somehow I didn't even know it. Got a thorn in my knee. That was on a Sunday afternoon. By the time Sunday night I get here, I couldn't even move my leg. I'm serious. Didn't know what happened. And Paul gets the thing, he starts looking at the thorn. And he talks about how a messenger of Satan came. What was he coming to do? Trying to get Paul's attention to be focused on the thorn. And he was on an accusation. And what does he do? He takes it to God the first time. No. He takes it to God the second time. No. And he's like, oh man, I know this third time. We've been that way. You know, if I can just fast 3 more days, if I can just pray this prayer 2 or 3 more times, he takes it the third time. And finally God says, hold up, man. I don't even speak thorn language. You keep coming to me about the thorn. I'm trying to get you to speak grace. He says, even in my weakness, what? His grace is what? Sufficient. Guess what the word sufficient means? It means to elevate. See, grace is not just God turning a blind eye to you this morning. Grace is your permanent abode. It is your identity.
Remember in John chapter 15 when Jesus starts rattling off, I'm the vine, you're the branches. You notice he's speaking in languages that they can understand because they had grapes everywhere. See, he's using things. And he says, any branch that doesn't produce, King James says, oh, he taketh it away. Right? Husbandman, take it away. How many of y'all thought, my Lord? What a gospel there, you know? I mean, what do you start doing? You start reevaluating yourself almost every day. Yeah. And you start, you know, oh, you know what? I mean, I've done this in a service or encounter somebody. I should have said this, or I shouldn't have said that, or you know what I'm saying? Things like that. But that's not what he said. It doesn't mean he takes away. It means he elevates it. Yeah. It's the same word that Paul uses in that says that his grace is sufficient. His grace elevates you. It lifts you up. It causes you to live the life that you're designed to. Isaiah would get this when he said that they grow weary, they grow tired, they hit a dead end. But what? When they wait upon the Lord, and that doesn't mean to sit down and twiddle your thumbs and wait for the coming of God, you know what I mean? And God's timing. No! It means that him that has his thoughts, one with God, what happens? Immediately, they mount up with wings as eagles. They begin to live the life they were designed to do. And when you start mounting up with wings, and when you start soaring in the heavens, guess what? Your time being trapped is no longer your conversation. Who cares how long I spent in drugs? That's no relevancy any longer. The only conversation that is that I've been raised together with him and made to sit together, because that never was my testimony anyway. I don't care where you're at this morning. It doesn't matter. The only testimony that's true about you is the one that was proclaimed in Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Have the faith of God. What do you mean this morning, right here, that you can be just as convinced as God is?
Praise the Lord.
Paul said to Corinthians, I determine to know only one thing. That is Christ. Him crucified. You can't ignore the cross. When we speak of the cross, we're speaking of the death, burial, and the resurrection. Hosea would start prophesying in Hosea chapter 6, and he said on the first day, he'll tear us down. What's he talking about? When he says he's going to tear us down. He's going to tear their mindsets. The concepts that have kept us trapped. Living far below the blueprint. Ephesians 2 said, dead in trespasses and sins. Ezekiel seen it as a valley of dry bones without a sense of identity to it whatsoever. Can you make it out, Ezekiel? You don't even ask him, can you make it out? What's even out there? He just says, can they live? Ezekiel has no even clue who it is. What it is. God, could you bliss out here 20 years ago when there
could have maybe had some hope. Come on, we said maybe we could have did something for him. We could have put something in there to revive him, to resuscitate him. He takes him to a place where there's absolutely no hope whatsoever, but his hope. Because there ain't but one hope. And he's encountered with the hope of God. He's encountered with the faith of God. He's encountered with the breath of God. And he says, can these bones live? And Ezekiel's response is the same way we've been trapped in religion, saying, well, if it be thy will, O Lord, they can live. He says, no, Ezekiel. Just sit here and watch me. I'm about to just perform the greatest miracle you've ever seen in your life. That's not what he says to Ezekiel. He says, you start speaking. You start releasing. Yeah. You start prophesying. Yeah. You start letting them know that it's the breath of God that causes you to live. And he said, all winds come from the north and from the south. Breath of God, breathe upon.
That's right.
What happened? They just simply responded. Have the faith. Be persuaded. Abraham, I need you to go in every city. I need you to go in every town. I need you to confront kings. Tell them, you're the father of a multitude. When you want me to do that, Lord? After he's born?
No.
Before there's any evidence of it.
Oh, yeah, right.
Can you imagine the weight of the words in the economy of God when he, in his incarnate form, says, it is finished. You're talking about the one who sees the end from the beginning. Announcing that it is completed.
Yeah.
You know, the truth of the matter is this, Lord, that when that stone was rolled away, the door is now open for every man to soar into heavens. Every man to live the life he was designed to be, without fear, without worry. Because when we look at the faith of God, Hebrews 1 again talks about how, you know, he spoke to us in times past and stuff like that. And he says he's the brightness of his glory. The expression of his image. And that word there is the same word used in Hebrews 11:1, where it says, now faith is the substance. So Jesus is the faith of God. And you know what's so beautiful about that? That he's the same yesterday, today.
Oh yeah.
You can go as far back as you can go to yesterday, and God's persuasion of you hasn't changed. You can go into the future as far as you want to go, and you can be sure that everything's going to be all right. Why? Because it's the same yesterday, today, and forever. You know, the mountain's not waiting this morning for God to move on. It's just waiting for you to say something. It's not even waiting for you to go take it to God in prayer. Because it says, whoever shall say. And that's not just you talking directly to the mountain. That's you having a conversation. A continuing conversation where the mountain is excluded from it. Because it can only be a reference. The reference of the majority when they came to the entrance to the land of promise. They all agreed. All 12 of them agreed that what God said about that land through Moses was absolutely correct.
The land is flowing with milk and honey. Come on. There's grapes over there that one man can't even get a hold of.
Could you imagine that?
It takes two of them just to carry. I mean, you go to Publix and you get you a grape and you pull out a little cluster, you can hold it in two fingers. And they're all coming to agreement that there's so much abundance of a provision that they didn't even plant. They had nothing to do with it. It's right there. Except for, in their eyes, there was an undefeated foe. There's giants and illusion. When God said it's all yours. See, Paul said that every promise in Jesus Christ is what? Yes. And amen. You don't have to live in a sense of distance this morning or delay. Just say to the mountain. What do you do after you say to the mountain? You do like Jesus did. You go on and eat you some lunch or something. Just spend time with your family. You go on about your business. Because while you're doing that, the Word's working. Amen. God bless you this morning.